بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما خلقنا السماوات والأرض وما بينهما إلا بالحق وإن الساعة لآتية فاصفح الصفح الجميل. إن ربك هو الخلاق العليم. ولقد آتيناك سبعا من المثاني والقرآن العظيم. لا تمدن عينيك إلى ما متعنا به أزواجا منهم ولا تحزن عليهم واخفض جناحك للمؤمنين. وقل إني أنا النذير المبين. كما أنزلنا على المقتسمين الذين جعلوا القرآن عضين. فوربك لنسألنهم أجمعين عما كانوا يعملون. فاصدع بما تؤمر وأعرض عن المشركين. إنا كفيناك المستهزئين. الذين يجعلون مع الله إلها آخر فسوف يعلمون. ولقد نعلم أنك يضيق صدرك بما يقولون. فسبح بحمد ربك وكن من الساجدين. واعبد ربك حتى يأتيك اليقين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أتى أمر الله فلا تستعجلوه. سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. ينزل الملائكة بالروح من أمره على من يشاء من عباده أن أنذروا أنه لا إله إلا أنا فاتقون. خلق السماوات والأرض بالحق تعالى عما يشركون. خلق الإنسان من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين. والأنعام خلقها لكم فيها دفء ومنافع ومنها تأكلون. ولكم فيها جمال حين تريحون وحين تسرحون. وتحمل أثقالكم إلى بلد لم تكونوا بالغيه إلا بشق الأنفس. إن ربكم لرؤوف رحيم. والخيل والبغال والحمير لتركبوها وزينة. ويخلق ما لا تعلمون. وعلى الله قصد السبيل ومنها جائر. ولو شاء لهداكم أجمعين. هو الذي أنزل من السماء ماءً لكم منه شراب ومنه شجر فيه تسيمون ينبت لكم به الزرع والزيتون والنخيل والأعناب ومن كل الثمرات إن في ذلك لآية لقوم يتفكرون وسخر لكم الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر والنجوم مسخرات بأمره إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يعقلون وما ذرأ لكم في الأرض مختلفا ألوانه إن في ذلك لآية لقوم يذكرون وهو الذي سخر البحر لتأكلوا منه لحما طريا وتستخرجوا منه حلية تلبسونها وترى الفلك مواخر فيه ولتبتغوا من فضله ولعلكم تشكرون وألقى في الأرض رواسي أن تميد بكم وأنهارا وسبلا لعلكم تهتدون وعلامات وبالنجم هم يهتدون أفمن يخلق كمن لا يخلق أفلا تذكرون وإن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها إن الله لغفور رحيم وإن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها إن الله لغفور رحيم والله يعلم ما تسرون وما تعلنون والذين يدعون من دون الله لا يخلقون شيئا وهم يخلقون أموات غير أحياء وما يشعرون أيان يبعثون إلهكم إله واحد فالذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة قلوبهم منكرة وهم مستكبرون لا جرم أن الله يعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون إنه لا يحب المستكبرين
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته We begin in the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful. We believe in Him, for it is by believing in Him that our lives become purposeful. We put our trust in Him, for it is by putting our trust in Him that we become hopeful. We thank Him for all our blessings, for He has been unto us most bountiful. And we send salat upon His final prophet, for amongst all of the prophets, He was the most successful. Today, insha'Allah ta'ala, we will be doing two Meccan surahs, and we're going to begin with Surah Al-Ḥijr. And Surah Al-Ḥijr is a short, sweet surah. It's a five-page surah, relatively short surah, that was revealed most likely in the middle part of the Meccan era. And the primary theme of this surah, along with the general themes of all Meccan surahs, the primary theme is the fate of those who reject the truth in this world, and hence it discusses stories of the past, and in the next world, and hence it discusses the punishment for those who reject the truth. And the name name Hijr, it means the people of the caverns or the people of the mountains, because it is a reference to those people who carved their houses into the mountains, as we will see. And it is a relatively short surah. It's 1/4 of the juz, 99 verses. A lot of the verses are relatively small. And it's a very quick, easy surah. And we're going to then move on to the longer surah. So we have to go over this one in our first 10-15 minutes. The surah begins with the famous letters Alif, Lam, Ra. And of course, up until now, I have glossed over all of these what are called muqatta'at, or the disjointed or the broken letters. And this is a very deep topic that we can literally discuss for many hours, but I will summarize by saying, out of all of the 20 opinions that we have in our earliest sources, perhaps the one that makes the most sense is that these letters are meant to bring attention and also to demonstrate that the Quran, even though it is composed of the same letters as mortal speech, yet it is not mortal speech, it is divine. And that is why every single time we find these huruf al-muqatta'at, these disjointed letters, whether it is alif lam mim or ha mim or noon or qaf or yasin, whatever we come across these letters at the beginning of the surahs, the very next section always discusses something to do with the Quran. So these letters seem to indicate the miraculous nature of the Quran. They seem to indicate the power of the Quran, that the Quran is composed of your letters, but it is not your speech. And that is because, of course, it is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this surah begins with Alif Lam Ra. Tilka ayatul kitab. These are the verses of the book, and these are the verses of the book. This is a Quran that is making things very clear. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Rubama yawaddu alladhina kafaru law kanu muslimin." That the day will surely come. It's only a matter of time, certainly, that those people who rejected, they will wish that they had been Muslim. So before that certainty sets in, let us take precautions so that we already accept before the regret will come. When it will come, it will be too late. As Allah says in verse 3, that let them enjoy, let them eat, let them be lulled by their hope, that they're going to be misguided by their own desires. فَسَوْفَ يَعْلَمُونَ. They will find out. It's only a matter of time. And once again, just as in the previous chapters, we are told that those who refuse to believe from the miracles of the world around them, those who refuse to believe from the miracle of the Quran, they will not believe via any other mechanism either. If a person is too blind to appreciate the miracles around him, then every other miracle as well will fall on deaf ears and blind eyes. And this, and then comes one of the most powerful and important predictions of the entire Quran, verse number 9. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. Surely we have sent down this remembrance, and without a doubt we will protect this remembrance, this Quran. And this is a great blessing. One of the biggest blessings that Allah has given us is the blessing of having our book protected. All the other books, Allah says, the protection was entrusted to their followers. In the other surah, bima istuhfidhu min kitabillah, that Allah says, they had to trust their own book. They took protection of their book. Well, that was a human effort, and eventually every nation failed. As for our Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself has taken charge of his protection, and that is why, alhamdulillah, we thank Allah, there are no different versions of the Quran. There are no different printings of the Quran. The Quran is essentially one. Yes, there are different qira'at, which are very, very trivial differences in the pronunciation, and they all go back to the earliest of times, but there is no substantial difference. If you look at any other scripture of any other faith tradition, the differences are palpable, they are extreme. As for us, alhamdulillah, the same Quran is read across the globe. The Quran that was commissioned by Uthman radiallahu anh, and it is the same exact Quran across the entire globe. And this is a miracle without a doubt, and it is a great blessing as well. As we mentioned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says that if you're not going to believe in the miracle of the Quran, if you're not going to believe in the miracles around you, nothing else will help you. So in verse 14, وَلَوْ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَابًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. Even if we opened up a door into the heavens and they began to ascend into the heavens and they could see with their eyes everything there, what would they do? لَقَالُوا إِنَّمَا سُكِّرَتْ أَبْصَارُنَا بَلْ نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ مَسْحُورُونَ. They would say, our eyes are hallucinating. Rather, we are a people that are bewitched. They would not believe even if they saw with their own eyes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then tells us that He is well aware that not all people are the same. There are those who want to strive forward. There are those who want to worship Allah. And there are those who go back. In verse number 24, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْنَا الْمُسْتَقْدِمِينَ مِنْكُمْ وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْنَا الْمُسْتَأْخِرِينَ. We know those who want to push forward. They want to be in the first ranks. We know those as well who want to go to the back. And so those who want to push forward, those who want to be the best of the best, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is monitoring them. And it is said that this verse was actually revealed about those people who would come early to the masjid to get the first sufuf, to be close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those who would grudgingly come, lazily come, and they would be at the very back, and they would just barely pray and then rush away. And Allah is saying, we know who is eager and we know who is not eager. And of course, the verse applies to any situation. Those who are pushing forward and dedicated and sincere, Allah Azza wa Jal has a record of them. And those that are the opposite, Allah has a record of them as well. The surah, along with so many other surahs, also mentions the story of Adam and Iblis. And every time the same story is repeated, you can be guaranteed, you can be assured that there will be a new benefit, a new point. Allah does not repeat without a cause. The entire Quran does have repetitions, but each time the surah comes with the same story, there's a new benefit, there's a new verse, there's a new moral that we can extract. So for example, in Surah Al-Hijr, verse 40, that Iblis promises that he is going to delude, he's going to misguide all of mankind. Then Iblis says, but there's one category that I will not be able to reach. And that's important for us. Iblis is confessing that he cannot reach one category. إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلِصِينَ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. That except for your chosen and sincere servants, I will not be able to get to them. Those that are sincere for you, O Allah, and those that are chosen by you, O Allah, they're off my limits. So we want to be automatically protected by being sincere and by being the chosen. So Allah announces that indeed this is the right way for me. هذا صراط علي مستقيم. This is going to be what I have decreed. That إن عبادي ليس لك عليهم سلطان. Over my servants, you will have no authority except those who choose to follow and take the sinful path. Those who choose Allah, shaitan has no authority over them. And Allah has announced this, and shaitan has confessed that I know I have no power, I can't get to them. And therefore those who choose Allah, and those who worship Allah, and those who are frequent in Allah's dhikr, shaitan, there is a barrier between them and shaitan, as we learn in the hadith. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then announces as well for all of mankind, verses 49 to 50. نَبِّئْ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ. Announce to my servants and inform them that I am the Ghafoor and I am the Rahim. I forgive and I am merciful. And also tell them that my punishment is a painful punishment. Notice the phrasing of this verse. Allah describes Himself in the first person. He describes His nature. By nature, He is merciful. And He speaks in the first person that I am merciful. I am forgiving. And then, and that shows us the default is mercy. And then Allah characterizes His punishment. And he goes, my punishment, that punishment is painful, and that punishment is indeed severe. And so the bottom line is that to get Allah's mercy, that is the default. If you want Allah's mercy, you will get Allah's mercy. But to get punishment, you really have to be messed up. You really have to work in a very unnatural way and do things that are very bad that no person should do in order to get those punishments. Anyone who chooses Allah, anyone who wants Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it puts in the effort, Allah azza wa jal will accept that effort from them. The story also has, this surah also has the story of Ibrahim and Lut. And once again we have the story of the angels coming to the house of Lut. That in verse number 67, that his people came to him yastabshirun, very eager, very happy, and of course they wanted to do what they wanted to do. And Lut pleaded with them, قَالَ إِنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ ضَيْفِي فَلَا تَفْطَحُونَ. That these are my guests, don't embarrass me. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُخْزُونِي. And fear Allah and don't humiliate me. So Lut was alone and he's surrounded by a mob who want to have their lustful ways with these young men. They thought, they didn't realize that they were angels. And so Lut is trying his best to inflict or to put the fear of God in them, because he doesn't have anyone to protect. The whole townspeople have come and he doesn't have anyone to protect. So he's saying, these are my guests. This is my, they're coming to my house. You know, don't do this to me. And then as a father figure and as the prophet, he says that if you must, then repent from your ways, turn over and you leave, and I will give you my daughters or any of the ladies that are single, I will give them to you in a halal marriage. And of course, the meaning here is that if they repent from their ways and if they turn over and you leave, then the way that you satisfy this desire, which is a natural desire, the way that you satisfy it is the natural way within the confines of marriage. And so Lut offers them, and this shows us as well that any time there is an urge that exists, there is always a halal mechanism to satisfy that urge. Every base instinct of man, whether it is to eat, whether it is to drink, whether it is the instinct of procreation, every instinct of man that Allah has put in us, there is a halal way to satisfy it. And if we are happy and content with the halal, inshaAllah ta'ala, there's no need to go to the haram. And those that have haram urges, they have to control them and not act upon them to the best of their abilities. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then describes the people of Lut in a very, very harsh verse, verse 72. لَعَمْرُكَ إِنَّهُمْ لَفِي سَكْرَتِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. Allah gives a qasam by the life of the Prophet ﷺ. I swear by your life, Ya Rasulullah, certainly they are wandering blindly, intoxicated and drunk in their own lust. This verse shows us a reality that we all know. Addiction is of many types. It's not just addiction to alcohol. Addiction is of many types. And the Quran here uses the word addiction or intoxication or drunkenness for another dangerous addiction. And that is the addiction of one's sensual pleasures to the point of it becoming outside the bounds of permissibility. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses some very harsh language that I want you to think about and ponder. When you become drunk, you act in a manner that is unbecoming. When you become drunk, you do things that are undignified, indecent. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that people who are so lustful in an unnatural manner, it is possible they become drunk in their addiction. So we have to be careful to keep our urges within the halal, or else if we just let them go, then this verse might apply to us as well. We seek Allah's refuge. The next story that is mentioned is the story of the people of Shu'aib. And these are called the people of the forest. And then the people of the Hijr, or the stone valleys. And this is the people of Salih. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of His blessings on them and makes them examples for the Quraysh that don't follow their path. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to the end of the surah and He reminds the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of the gift of the Qur'an in that very beautiful verse, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِّنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. Surely we have given you the seven oft-repeated verses and the magnificent Qur'an. This is that verse that mentions the seven oft-repeated verses, that is Surah Al-Fatiha. Nothing is recited more than Surah Al-Fatiha. And Surah Al-Hijr reminds us of this. And then the surah concludes with some very beautiful advice. Firstly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is commanded, verse 85, فَصْفَحْ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ. Forgive the people who irritate you in the most beautiful of forgiveness. Turn away, turn the other cheek. فَصْفَحْ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ. To those who irritate you, forgive them. And to those who believe in you, verse 88, وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Lower your wings unto them. What a beautiful metaphor, that as if the Prophet ﷺ is like the mother bird, is lowering the wings, you know, protecting. This is a metaphor, obviously. And the point here is that be merciful, be gentle, be protective to the believers. So lower your wings unto them. You are the father figure. You are the one they're looking up to. So be gentle with them. Be merciful upon the believers. And he is consoled at the very end of the surah. Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'in. We are sufficient for you to protect you against those who mock you. That anybody who mocks you, Ya Rasulullah, I will deal with them. You don't have to worry about them. And then the surah concludes with three verses that I myself always am reminded of when I am in a distressful situation. And the Quran as well, this is one of those verses that anyone who is going through a painful time, anyone who is going through any situation that is stressful, remember these verses. Verse number 97, وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. We are well aware that your heart is hurt because of what they say. Life is difficult. And for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most difficult aspect was the false accusations and the slanders that they did to his character. So Allah is saying, we know how you feel. What is the response? Verse 98, 99, the ending of the surah. فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَكُمْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. So glorify your Lord, praise your Lord, and be amongst those who prostrate, and continue to worship your Lord until certainty, meaning death, comes to you. In other words, that energy or that negativity or that sadness that you feel, channel it and connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and dissolve that grief in the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the praise of Allah, you will find your comfort. In lowering your head in front of Allah, you will find your happiness. Anytime life becomes difficult, turn to Allah. This is what our Prophet is being told, that we know your heart is at grief. What should you do when you're feeling the pains of this dunya? Don't complain to mere mortals. They cannot solve your problems. Don't seek pity from other created objects. What can they do? Turn to Allah. Glorify Allah. Lower your head, not in front of other men. Lower your head in front of Allah. وَكُمْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ. And continue to be busy in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until certainty comes to you. Anyone who's feeling pain and anguish and anxiety, and all of us do, when we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it helps us to cope with that. So that surah Al-Ḥijr. We now move on to Surah Al-Naḥl. And Surah Al-Naḥl is also a Makki surah. Perhaps one or two verses were revealed in Medina and then, you know, added here. But it is overall a Makki surah, and it has 126 verses. And it consists of 15 pages in the standard, you know, Madani Mus'haf that is printed these days. Around 3/4 of the Jews is Surah Al-Naḥl, and 1/4 is Surah Hijr. And this surah, it was called by some of the companions the Surah An-Ni'am, the Surah of Blessings. Some Sahaba would call this the Surah of Blessings. Why? Because the entire surah is a listing of one blessing after another. And all it is a summary of some of the biggest blessings that Allah has given us. And the goal of this surah is to remind mankind of the blessings of Allah, and then through that reminding to encourage them to then be thankful and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, by being reminded of the powers of creation around us, by being reminded of the world around us, we are reminded of the power of Allah and the capability of Allah to bring the creation back again. The one who created all of this can surely recreate us after death and bring us back to life. And this surah as well, by the way, has a lot of commonly quoted chapters and passages that all of us hear in Friday sermons and various lectures. So I'll summarize this surah. And again, it's a very easy surah to read. Please, brothers and sisters, especially those who haven't read the Quran, please use this as an opportunity to dive in and read the Quran for yourself. You will see it opens up a whole new window. You will have a whole different experience. Try, just try, and you will see that inshaAllah ta'ala, the messages you will gain will benefit you in your personal life, and especially listen to the Arabic recitation as well. So this surah dives in immediately to the blessings of Allah. Read it again, it's very straightforward. The blessings of sending the Quran down, the miracle of creating man from a drop, the cattle that Allah has benefited from, has caused you to benefit from, the animals that you ride, the horses and the steeds that you ride. Allah says, for example, in verse 7, that these animals that I gave you with, you would not be able to travel on distances, on journeys. You would not be able to go travel except with great difficulty. And then this section culminates in verse 17. أَفَمَنْ يَخْلُقُ كَمَنْ لَا يَخْلُقُ. The one who creates, is he the same as the one who does not create? Don't you think? And then verse 18, and if you tried to count the blessings of Allah, you would not be able to count them. The same phrase that occurred in the previous Surah Ibrahim, it occurs over here as well. But the ending here, Allah is forgiving and merciful. Wallahu ghafoor rahim. The ending over there, mankind is arrogant and mankind is unjust. Mankind doesn't do justice to Allah. Look at how the contrast is. This is an interesting point. Anytime a similar or same verse occurs, look at the differences in the context. This phrase, if you were to count the blessings of Allah, occurs twice in the Quran. You're not going to be able to count them. Once Allah says, and I am forgiving and merciful. Once Allah says, and mankind is ungrateful. Put the two together. Despite our ungratefulness, Allah continues to forgive. So Allah Azza wa Jal reminds us that the one who creates, meaning Him, Allah Azza wa Jal, is not like the one who does not create, meaning the false gods. And Allah has given you so much that you cannot even thank Him. And the verse, as I said, has so many blessings. I can't go over all of them. But for example, verse 65 to 81, Allah mentions again so many blessings, including, for example, milk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, وَإِنَّ لَكُمْ فِي الْأَنْعَامِ لَعِبْرَةً. Certainly there is a sign for you in the cattle that we cause to flow. We cause to flow. You do not create that milk. We cause it to flow from the stomachs of these animals. Between the filth and between blood, there comes لَبَنًا خَالِصًا سَالًا. Pure, healthy milk that people want to drink. SubhanAllah, the intestines, when we open it up, if we have to slaughter the animal, it's so disgusting, we can't even look at it, we cannot even smell it, much less think about, you know, doing anything. From this filth, in between the blood, and in between the feces that is there, between that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, from within all of that system, I have allowed this pure, untouched, absolutely delectable delight. We can drink it, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I am the one who has caused you to drink it. Nusqikum, I have fed you this. And subhanAllah, these animals, they give surplus. Because Allah Azza wa Jal created them to give surplus. Allah created these animals to give so much because they were meant for us and not just for their offspring. And of course, we as Muslims firmly believe that these animals, we have the right to utilize them and to take their food and their milk if we treat them in a proper manner. And of course, in this series as well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the blessings of honey as well. That's why the surah is called Surah Al-Naḥl. Naḥl means the bee. And why is it called the bee? Verse number 68. Your Lord inspired the bee. وَأُوحَ رَبُّكَ إِلَى النَّحْلِ. That go ahead and make your houses. Make your houses. Set up your hives in the mountains and in the trees and in what men build. So Allah has given the bees permission to build. Now, of course, this doesn't mean if you have a beehive in your house, you're not allowed to get rid of it. No, I mean, they are allowed to do that, and we are also allowed to protect our property. So it's a two-way thing here, and if we want to, we have the right to remove the beehive if it's going to be harmful to us. But Allah is saying, go ahead and build beehives in the mountains and in the trees and in what men make, and then eat from all of the fruits of this world, and fly along the highways that Allah has created for you with precision. And the bees know, subhanAllah, just like the birds, they know the lay of the land, they're able to go around with precision. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَخْرُجُ مِن بُطُونِهَا شَرَابٌ, that from the bellies of the bees there comes a liquid, a fluid, مُخْتَلِفٌ أَلْوَانُهُ, of diverse colors. And so the honey that is produced, it is of many diverse colors. You have darkish honey, you have a lightish honey, you have absolute white honey, you have a whole array of honey. And then Allah says, فِيهِ شِفَاءٌ لِلنَّاسِ, in honey there is cure, there is healing, there is medicinal properties. And of course, our modern scientists and doctors, they say that honey helps boost the immune system. And anything that helps boost the immune system, obviously it will help all arrays of diseases. And so honey is one of the things that the Quran itself recommends to take regularly. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, surely in this is a sign for people who reflect. The surah also has a section, verses 22 to 30, about the fate of those who reject the prophets and reject the day of judgment. How the angels will take their soul, how the angel of death will punish them, what they will be told on judgment day, and then eventually how they will be admitted into the gates of hell. فَادْخُلُوا أَبْوَابَ جَهَنَّمَ. And the next section, 30 to 32, contrasts this with those who believe in the Qur'an and how their death will be an easy and good death. الَّذِينَ تَتَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ الطَّيِّبِينَ يَقُولُونَ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. When the angels come to take their souls, the angels will say, Salam, Salamu alaykum, peace be unto you. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the righteous, when their soul leaves the body, it will be like water that you just pour it from a jug. how smoothly the water comes out, so too the soul will leave the body. And the unrighteous, the wicked, the rejectors of Allah, when their souls attempt to leave the body, it is like a wet wool being dragged through an iron comb. How difficult that is how that is going to be. We seek Allah's refuge. And then the people of righteousness, فَدْخَلُوا أَبْوَابَ الْجَنَّةِ, they enter the gates of Jannah. And we are also reminded in this section that the battle between prophets and the rejectors is a constant one, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent hundreds, thousands of prophets. We're reminded of the continuity of the prophets in Surah Al-Naḥl, verse 36, that, and we sent to every single nation a Rasul, that every single qawm, every single people has been sent a Rasul. أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتِ. The message was the same. Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and avoid all falsehood, all false god and all false ways and all everything that is unethical and immoral. Worship Allah perfectly and avoid all that is evil. This has been the message of all the prophets, universal. Verse number 43 as well reminds us of the continuity of the message. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ. We have sent before you so many men, we have inspired them. Nothing new. Prophets are many. And the hadith tells us more than 124,000 prophets have been sent. And yet, of course, we know amongst them only a select category. An interesting passage in this surah as well. Again, the purpose of this lecture is to just point out and highlight some passages. An interesting passage in this surah is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the people of Arabia and their attitude towards the birth of daughters. Subhanallah, you're all aware that when Islam came, the people of Arabia, the people, certain tribes especially amongst them, they were very, very preferential to boys over girls. So much so, a'udhu billah, that if a girl was born, sometimes they would, a'udhu billah, practice what is called female infanticide, one of the most vulgar, evil practices known to man, and that is to kill your own children. And they would kill them for multiple reasons. Of them is that they felt that the girl is not the same as a boy in terms of worth and value. Of them is that they had to spend money on the girl rather than the boy, they would eventually would give, bring money back. And of them, of course, the marriage dowry, the father had to give for to the groom so that the girl is married. So Islam came and changed all of this, absolutely. And one of the things that it changed very successfully in most cultures, unfortunately, it still remains in some pockets, we seek Allah's refuge. One of the things that changed was the attitude, the negativity that would come when a girl is born. That rather than embracing and enjoying, rather than being happy that a person has been gifted a girl, they would be sad at this. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in verses 57 to 59. That وَيَجْعَلُونَ لِلَّهِ الْبَنَاتِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَلَهُمْ مَا يَشْتَهُونَ. That they accuse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of having daughters, because the Quraysh, their theology was that the idols that they worship were the daughters of Allah, Al-Lat and Al-Uzza and Al-Manat, that they had daughters. So Allah says that, what type of theology is this, that you ascribe daughters to yourself, and you then negate those daughters from yourselves. وَلَهُمْ مَا يَشْتَهُونَ. And you prefer another gender. If you're giving any gender to the children of God, then why wouldn't you also want that same gender for your own children? That's a contradiction. And of course, Allah doesn't have children in the first place. And then Allah uses some very, very blunt descriptions, very sad descriptions also. وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى. When one of them is given the good news, Allah is calling it a good news. وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ, when they get the good news of a female, what happens? ظَلَّ وَجُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. His face becomes cloudy and dark. Rather than being a good news and being happy, when the good news of the girl comes, his face becomes dark and he becomes choked with grief. He becomes very, very anxious. يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ. He hides himself from the people because of the shame that the bad news has given him. You know, when a shameful thing happens, you just go and hide. So when the daughter is born, rather than being happy and saying, hey, alhamdulillah, I have a new child, a new baby girl, rather than that, he is hiding. يَتَوَارَى. He is hiding from his people because of the bad news that has come to him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that the man is thinking that should he keep him in humiliation, أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ, or kick and bury the girl in the dust. أعوذ بالله. These are the two choices, that should he keep the girl in humiliation and just bear with the undignity of keeping this girl, or أعوذ بالله, should he just kick the girl and bury and just dig a grave and أعوذ بالله, get rid of it. And then Allah says, سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. What an evil choice, what an evil choice that this person has to make. Subhanallah, in these verses, Allah is severely criticizing, harshly mocking this attitude. And thereby, by mocking and criticizing the attitude of those people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in fact praising the concept of having girls. And in fact, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he only had daughters that lived to maturity. His boys that he had, they passed away before they were even young boys. Only the girls, they lived until maturity. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he promised that whoever has daughters and treats them with kindness, that those daughters, until they are married, that those daughters will be a shield between him and Jahannam. The daughters will be the shield for the man to protect him from Jahannam. Treating your daughters kindly is your mechanism to get into Jannah. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, every time Fatima would come, Aisha comments, because she said, I never saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam be so happy when somebody came to visit, like his daughter Fatima would come. That when his daughter, his youngest daughter would come, Fatima, whenever she would come to visit, he would stand up, he would smile, beam, the room would fill up with light, and he would kiss the forehead of Fatima, and he would sit, he would cause Fatima to sit on his own chair, and he used to say, Fatima is a piece of me, bud'atu minni, like we say in English, she's a piece of my heart, Fatima is a piece of me, she is a part of me. And of course, yani, subhanAllah, all of this, Islam came to change this attitude of girls being something negative. And subhanAllah, and alhamdulillah, yani, on a personal note, alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me with two boys and two girls. Alhamdulillah, boys, we thank Allah, alhamdulillah. But girls, mashallah, let's just put it like that. So Islam came and it taught mankind civilization. It taught mankind that girls are a blessing from Allah. Thank Allah you have girls. There's nothing wrong with this. So the Quran, Surah Al-Naḥl, which again is a mid to early Meccan surah, it is teaching people to enjoy and embrace the blessings of Allah and be happy when a child is given. And that's why in this surah as well, Allah mentions explicitly the blessings of family. Verse 72 and 78 as well. Read these verses. That وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَّكُم مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. Allah has gifted you from amongst yourselves spouses, and وَجَعَلَّكُمْ مِنْ أَزْوَاجِكُمْ بَنِينَ وَحَفَدًا, and from your spouses he has given you children and he's given you grandchildren. So even grandchildren are a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَرَزَقَكُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ, and he has given you so many good things. Will you then believe in falsehood and refuse the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? In verse 78 as well, وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought you out from the wombs of your mothers. لا تعلمون شيئا, you knew absolutely nothing. وجعل لكم السمع والأبصار والأفئدة, and he gave you hearing and eyesight and thinking, brains, so that you may give thanks. So All of these verses are just reminding us over and over again of the many, many blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And in these surahs as well, or in the surah Al-Nahl as well, we have another set of blessings. And again, subhanAllah, this whole surah is essentially the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In verses 80 onwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of the blessings of our houses. وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَكُمْ مِنْ بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا, that Allah has gifted you your houses to be a place of peace and a place of serenity. And this is again a very interesting verse. Psychologically, when we live in a place and we take it as our domicile, we find a familiarity, we find a contentment, we find a peace, a sakina in our house. And you know, I mean, I travel a lot all over the, you know, well, before the COVID pandemic, and I'll tell you, nothing beats home, nothing beats my bed, nothing beats what I am used to. It is a psychological blessing that Allah Azza wa Jal reminds us in the Quran. وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا. Your house, it has a psychological impact on you. You feel comfortable, inshallah. that that's the norm. Obviously, some people, they do have issues. But overall, alhamdulillah, your house, you feel that level of sakina. And Allah says, I am the one that has gifted you your houses. And your houses cause you to feel peaceful at it. And then, even your temporary houses, that wallahu ja'alakum bibidukum sakanam, wa ja'alakum min juludil an'ami buyutan. And He has gifted you from the skins of animals. He has gifted you houses, meaning what? Tents. تَسْتَخِفُونَهَا يَوْمَ ضَعْنِكُمْ وَيَوْمَ إِقَامَتِكُمْ. And from these leathers and tents, that you can roll them up and carry them with you when you travel, and then you can put the tent up when you pause on your journey. In other words, this beautiful aspect of having a portable house, and that's of course the tent that is common for the people to do. Allah is saying, where did you get that from? I gave it to you. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says that He gave you clothing from the animals, you know, the fur that they would wear to protect themselves from the cold, and to have thick armor as well. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this, that He has gifted this to us. تَقِيكُمُ الْحَرَّ. It protects you in your heat, it protects you in your cold, and it protects you in your times of war. كَذَلِكَ يُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. All of this, He has perfected His favors upon you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُسْلِمُونَ. So that you may submit to Him. And in all of these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us over and over again. I have to just pause here for a little bit, because these verses are so explicit, and I know that there's a lot of questions that people have. As you know, I'm not allowed to go into tangents in today's, in this series. Nonetheless, this isn't an unintentional tangent. This is something that is planned, that when Allah is mentioning all of these animals and cattle, and Allah is saying you eat some of these animals, Allah is saying you benefit from their milk, Allah is saying that I allowed you to ride them, Allah is saying that you use their skin to make tents, use their skin to protect yourselves in the heat, to protect yourselves in the cold, to do this and that. All of this, it leads us to a very important point, and that is that we have been given the authority by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to humanely use what animals give us, humanely. Now, what is humanely? The Sharia has come with a long list, and the books of fiqh talk about that. But overall, the concept that is now common in some segments of today's society, that we should not use any animal products, that it is not fair to eat the meat of animals, it is unethical to do anything with animals, that we should just let them be. We have to be very clear here that this can only stem from an ideology and a faith that does not believe in a higher power and does not believe in a hierarchy of living beings. You see, the Quran is very clear. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jal has made all of this for you, as long as we take care of it and do it properly, and we deal with animals humanely and treat them in an ethical fashion. Yes, if we do this, then when we mention the name of Allah, we are allowed to sacrifice, we're allowed to eat of their meat, we're allowed to take of their milk, we're allowed to take their eggs, whatever it is, as long as it is done. And of course, this is not the time to get into all of these other rules. Allow me just one rule, then I'll get back to the topic at hand. So once a person invited the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for a feast, and he stood up to sacrifice an animal. So the Prophet ﷺ said, be careful, don't sacrifice an animal that still has a young one taking milk from it. Only take one that is now, there's no one else dependent on it. SubhanAllah. Look, yani the Prophet ﷺ, to this point, he is thinking that even though the host, it's his business where he's going and which animal, the Prophet is saying, be careful, don't sacrifice one halub that still is giving milk to its young one, or else the young one will then be left without milk. No, don't do that. We are allowed to benefit from animals. And that's why, and I said this here, because Surah Al-Naḥl, is a lot of it is about animals. As we mentioned, the bee itself is an animal. And Allah Azza wa Jal is explicitly allowing us to benefit from their products if it is harvested in a humane fashion, and if the animals are treated ethically and normally, and if they are sacrificed in accordance with the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, having said that, before I move on, if somebody personally chooses that, I personally don't like to taste animal, I don't like meat, I like to eat vegetables, that's a personal preference. And on a personal note, I'll say you're really missing out, but that's your business. If a person doesn't want to eat meat, that's their business. But the minute somebody says, it is disgusting, it is unethical, how dare you eat meat, What they are doing is they are challenging the hierarchy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put into place. And they are rejecting on a theological level. Nobody's forcing you to eat a particular cuisine or a particular item. If you don't like it, you don't like it. But the minute you problematize what Allah has not problematized, the minute you come and you say something that should not be said, then this is a problem. Now I get back to the verse. It is explicit in the context of lawful and unlawful food items, because Allah does mention in the surah some lawful and unlawful food items. Verse 116. Listen to this verse. That, and do not say a falsehood. Do not speak by asserting falsehood with your tongue. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ Do not say falsehoods asserted and pushed by your tongue. هَذَا حَلَال وَهَذَا حَرَام That this is halal and this is haram. لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ In order that you are showing that you're demonstrating lies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verily, those who invent lies and attribute them to Allah shall never be successful. We have to be very, very careful, dear Muslims. Never, ever say something is haram or halal based upon your ignorance, based upon your lack of study, based upon your personal opinion. No, this is the Sharia of Allah. If you don't like something, say, I don't like it, I don't want to do it, end of story. But for you to say, oh, it is unethical, it is haram, it is disgusting, and you make a categorization of something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made halal, and you say it is haram, or vice versa, if Allah has made something haram, and you say that it is halal, Allah azza wa jalla is saying, you are blaspheming against Allah. Don't do this. لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ Those who blaspheme against Allah and say lies against Allah, they will never be successful. So, in all of this, getting back to the surah, what is the purpose of reminding us of all of these blessings? Verse 82 and 83. If they turn away, your job is only to communicate. As for them, يَعْرِفُونَ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُنْكِرُونَهَا They recognize the blessings of Allah and they still end up denying them. They recognize the blessings of Allah and they still deny them, and most of them are ungrateful. So verse 83 explains to us what is one of the main purposes of mentioning all of these blessings. To recognize and then to be grateful, not to deny. So we have to be very cognizant of all of these blessings of Allah. This surah is called the surah of blessings. This surah has that famous verse in it that if you try to count the blessings of Allah, you will not be able to do so. Surah Al-Naḥl, by the way, before we conclude the last paragraphs, Surah Al-Naḥl also, it has that famous verse that is recited in every single Jumu'ah khutbah across the globe for the last 1,300 years. And this is verse 90 of Surah Al-Naḥl. That إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون Allah commands three things and forbids three things, and He advises you, He exhorts you, He admonishes you so that you can pay heed. These three things that are advised and these three things that are forbidden, they summarize the entire ethical values of our faith tradition. إن الله يأمر بالعدل Allah commands that you treat with justice, that you do not be unjust, that if somebody does good to you, you do good to them, that even if somebody does evil to you, you can never do more than the evil that is done to them. بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ And if you go more than this and you are good, it is even better. إِحْسَان is to return evil with good. إِحْسَان is to do things perfectly. إِحْسَان is to be conscious of Allah in all that you do. إِحْسَان is to go the extra mile, that you don't just give back the same, you give back better. وَإِتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى And that you be generous to your family, you be good to your family, you are a person who makes sure the ties of family are fulfilled. These are the three that are commanded. وَيَنْهَى And He forbids immorality, fahsha, immorality, any type of indecency, and walmunkar, any type of injustice or bad deeds, walbaghi, and oppression, doing something to another person, that is something that you should not do. And He advises you so that you can pay heed. So after all of these blessings, the surah concludes by firstly reminding us of the Prophet Ibrahim, and secondly telling us how to preach unto others. As for reminding us of the Prophet Ibrahim, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً قَانِتَ لِلَّهِ حَنِيفًا وَلَمْ يَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ Verse 120, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ Verily Ibrahim was a one-man nation. One man unto himself was an entire ummah. إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً An ummah here means that he was a role model. Ummah here means that he was an imam of other people. And ummah here means that even though he was one person, it is as if he is an entire nation. That's how much piety he had. And why was he of that level? Well, of the reasons he worshipped Allah alone, of the reasons he turned away from idols, and of the reasons, شَاكِرًا لِأَنْعُمِهِ He was grateful for the blessings Allah gave him. Remember, this whole surah is the surah of blessings. What should we do with blessings? شَاكِرًا لِأَنْعُمِهِ How thankful are we of the blessings that Allah has given us? That our Prophet ﷺ said, the Prophet Nuh was a thankful servant of Allah. Every single sip of water that he would drink, not every glass, every sip of water that he would drink, every morsel of food that he would drink, he would pause and say, Alhamdulillah. For every sip that he would sip of water, he would thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is praising Ibrahim, شَاكِرًا لِأَنْعُمِهِ He was grateful of the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him. And the surah concludes with one of the most oft-quoted verses about the reality of preaching unto others. How do we preach to other people? That Allah says in verse 125, اُدْعُ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ It is the job of every single Muslim without exception to be a role model to the non-Muslims around him. It's not necessary that you debate, we're going to get to this in this verse, it's not necessary that you go beyond your means, but it is obligatory that at some level you positively impact your non-Muslims around you so that they can see in you the beauty of Islam. اُدْعُ All of you, without exception, call to the way of your Lord. The way of your Lord. With what? Three things are mentioned. بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ And our scholars mention each one of these three, it's done by different categories of people. As for hikmah, everybody is able to call with hikmah. And what does hikmah mean? In the wisest of all manners. And wisdom is something that it is something that you use your common sense. What is the best way to show the beauty of Islam? This changes from time to place to culture. It changes from who you are to what you're doing. But everybody should use their common sense and their wisdom about how to preach Islam. And generally speaking, it's very obvious that in the worlds that we live in, our akhlaq and our characters are of the best ways to preach Islam. Our generosity and our honesty, just being upright Muslims, this is one of the best ways to preach Islam, and this is hikmah. And then maw'idah. Maw'idah is a higher level. Not everybody is going to be able to do that. Maw'idah means a spiritual reminder, a moving talk that will shake them to their core. So these are, a maw'idah is a heart-to-heart. Now this requires, you know, some knowledge or a little bit of eloquence, but you know, honestly, anybody can speak from the heart about what Islam does. So your close friends that are non-Muslims, when the topic comes up, when the topic is right, open up to them and be honest with them what Islam makes you feel like, and what how Islam has affected your life, and how meaning comes through Islam. This is a maw'idah. Anyone is eloquent if they speak from the heart. It's really that simple, honestly. Yes, there is such a thing as the science of eloquence, but the number one rule that you learn as the eloquent person is very, very clear, and that is speak from the heart, and it will reach the heart. It's simple as that. So this is what maw'idah is. It's a heart speech from the heart that's going to get to the heart. And then the third category, wajadilhum, and debate with them in the best of all manners. Debate, but only those that you've tried hikmah, you've tried mu'idhat al-hasana, that hasn't worked, then the qualified people who know the faith, who know how to defend the faith, they will then step up to the challenge. These are the preachers and teachers, the scholars, and then they will debate in the best of manners. Don't ever debate in a crude manner. Never debate in an unethical manner. Never debate with a harsh language. وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنَ So this last verse of Surah Al-Naḥl, it concludes for us It's not the last verse, there's two verses after this, but this is the second to last or the third to last verse, and it demonstrates for us every single one of us is required by Allah to do whatever we can to the people around us so that they have the reality of the message of Islam presented to them. So today, inshallah, we have done Surah Al-Hijr and Surah Al-Naḥl. Tomorrow, we're going to move on to Surah Al-Isra and Surah Al-Kahf. And I encourage all of you to read at least Surah Al-Kahf in the translation because once again, we're going to try to just extract like we do with Surah Yusuf, although we won't have time because we're doing half of it Kahf and half of it Isra. But we're going to try to extract as many benefits from Surah Al-Kahf. And what this means is that if you have read it, will be far more beneficial. And with this, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us sincerity and ikhlas. We ask that Allah grants us the wisdom to preach unto people in the best of all manners. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He accepts our good deeds, forgives our sins, and exalts our ranks. I will see you inshallah tomorrow. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
وحملته في فلكك المشحون يا من أحال النار حول خليله روحا وريحانا